No, thank you, Sister Jenny.
Yes, sir.
Wonderful. Giving honor to God and to our pastor, Reverend Dr. Pierre J. Crawford. For this preaching opportunity.
I'd
like to thank our seniors on the Moves Ministry for selecting me as your speaker. I like the name Seniors on the Moves because, see, you still got a lot to do. And sometimes people retire and they think they're supposed to sit back. Oh, but it's really time to kick in gear. It's a whole other lifespan to be lived. So I'm excited about what God is doing through our ministry of the Seniors on the Move, our youth and our young adult. You just don't know how blessed you are to be in a multi-generational church.
Amen.
There's so much that we can learn from our seniors.
Amen.
All this that's going on in our communities with the police and with so much violence, you can talk to any one of them and they come through the 60s, the 50s, they know some things.
Amen.
They know what brought them through then. And they can tell us what will bring us through now.
Amen.
So I am thankful. You know, for a while I was dieting. And then every time I go, she'd have to put more down. I was trying to cover up some things, you know. And I jumped. We bought by a new company. They were bringing all these young people in. I said, I got to still look young. Keep up with it. I said, baby, just let it go. We just gonna fix it like it is. So I'm thankful. I'm thankful for the gray hair, because see, it took something to get it. Everybody didn't make it here. So I'm thankful this morning. There is a word from the Lord. And it can be found in Romans, the 5th chapter.
Yeah.
We're going to look at verse 3 and 5. Romans, the 5th chapter. We're going to look verses 3 and 5. And it reads like this. We can rejoice, too, when we run into problems and trials. For we know that they help us develop endurance. And endurance develops strength of character. And character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment. For we know how dearly God loves us. Because he has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with his love. And if you will, I had to choose a topic, it would be from problems to progress.
Amen.
From problems to progress. From problems to progress. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, I need you to hide me behind the cross. Lord, this is your word. So I need you, God, to speak to these, your people.
Yes.
That your word may go forth, God, with power and authority.
Yes.
That it will edify your people, God. And that it will horrify the devil.
Yes.
God, we give you glory, Lord, for your word.
Yes.
We thank you, Lord, for the plan of salvation and the plan that you had for our lives that you outlined in your word.
Yes.
We give you glory and we give you honor, Lord. Speak through these clay lips of mine. Use me, God, as an instrument in your hand. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. I need the
oh, bless me.
I need him, brothers and sisters, daily and three and four times a day. Hallelujah. When we look at our scripture today, a story is told of a man who worked for a cargo truck company. And he was sent to pick up a package at a private airport. And when he arrived at the private airport, this lady stepped out of an airplane with the largest cake that he had ever seen. Right. She'd been flown in to deliver this cake for a wealthy couple's large and extravagant wedding. The man, curious about the woman, asked her how she got into the business of flying giant wedding cakes. And the woman said it was caused by a tragedy. Several years back, her husband had died, and she was left alone, broke, and facing the challenge of raising three daughters by herself. As she sat in her home trying to figure out how she was going to make ends meet, there was one thing that she knew for sure, and that she could make cakes better than most people. And so she decided to start baking and selling cakes. Her cake sales immediately took off, and now she's flying huge wedding cakes across the country for extravagant events. Yeah. And she concluded she would tell the man it was a problem that propelled the start of her business. See, the moral of the story is what we call problems in truth are just challenges that face us to reach beyond our comfort zones. See, the Bible tells us to rejoice when we are faced with challenging moments because they are opportunity for personal growth. Like the story of the cake maker, many people never would have stepped out on faith except a problem or a trial presented itself that forced them to take the risk.
That's right.
That's the story of so many of God's children who were used by God to accomplish great things. Problems lead to progress. Just consider Paul. If Paul did not have the problem of hating Christians, he would have never had met Jesus on the road to Damascus. Because see, he was on that road going to persecute Christians. When Paul met Jesus, he lost his sight. And had he not lost his sight, he wouldn't have waited 3 days for Ananias to come and pray for him. Ananias then restored Paul's sight and instructed him in the ways of Jesus. And when Paul left Ananias, he was preaching the gospel and telling people about the power of the resurrection.
All right.
God took his old problem that he had with Saul, and he turned it into a new preacher called Paul. Right. So we see our problems always have a purpose. This is true individually as collectively. Even if we don't immediately see the good, just know that God is using every trial for his purpose. The first purpose of our problems, the Apostle Paul says, is to help us build endurance. It's God's ultimate vetting process to make sure that we are tough enough to stand faithfully when the road of righteousness gets tough. And any one of these seniors in here can tell you that the road will get tough. Not if it will, it will get tough. Just imagine training for a marathon. Pastor talks about this all the time. You can't go out on the day of the marathon,
right.
Strap on your sneakers, put them little bitty shorts on, and think that you're going to be able to run that race with those that are prepared.
That's right.
You just can't sit on the couch eating Oreos and sugar-coated bacon and for 6 months and think you're going to be ready to run in a marathon.
That's right.
Your body has to be prepared for the struggle that you're going to meet. Your body has to spiritually unfit to finish their Christian race.
Amen.
See, we have been faced with a lot of questions here lately. What you think about same-sex marriages, Regina? What you think about homosexuals, Regina? You got to know the word of God.
That's right.
Because we're being tested on every hand.
That's right.
That's why people who go through life without ever having a father problem, they fall apart if the first trial comes along. See, the word Paul uses for trials is often used to describe the process metals go through when they're refining it. When they find a metal in its roughest form, it doesn't look like gold right now. It comes out of the earth black, but they know that the gold is in there. They set it on the fire, and they turn that heat up. And all the impurities that's in there will begin to burn off. It'll begin to burn away. And after the process is through, then you can reach back in there and you come out with pure gold that shines and is of great value. So it is with our spiritual life. Sometimes it can feel like we too are inside of a furnace. But count it all short. Because see, there's some stuff that's got to be burned off. In order for us to complete this race and to please God in the process. Sometimes it's some selfishness that's got to be burned off. Sometimes it's unforgiveness that's got to be burned off. Oh God, thank you. Lord God, I thank you for what's been burned off in the fire. Because when it burns off, then we come out looking more like God. You know, I think the worst thing that we've done to our children is we wanted a better life for them. You know, we come through some times that were challenging. We had to do without some things. But I think we've handicapped our children. Because see, we didn't allow them to face problems.
Right.
We didn't allow them to go without.
Right.
We didn't allow them to go through the same things that we went through. But what we went through was hard, but it's good.
Yeah.
Because it made us better. It made us stronger.
Yeah.
Now we got kids, they have no idea what a tough time is. To correct our error. Because our young people got to understand that life is not going to always be easy. That there's some hard decisions that's got to be made. There's some sacrifices that's got to be made. You know, Brian's in school, and we give him money to live off of. And you send Brian some money, and the next week he called back. I said, babe, I put a little something in your account last week. Yes, ma'am, we went out and I eat a steak and I... Baby, you're going to have to learn how to budget. That was your money for all month long. And I'm sorry, but you're going to have to eat hamburgers or something else. Because we're not sending no more money. It's my fault. I know I done this. About what put you through that.
Amen.
And when you come out on the other side, you got something now that you didn't have when you were. If I could life is. That's why, young people, you need to get at the feet of some of these things. You need to share some things that's going on with you, because they can tell you a story that can help you through your situation. Most of God's greatest leaders endured long periods of suffering as they were shaped and hung for the work ahead. When you look at Paul, most of the writings of the New Testament, he was locked up. Not just in jail, but chained. Guards all around him. And even in that situation, he was thinking about promoting the gospel.
Amen.
After endurance, the second purpose of problems is to help us build character. Character, the definition of character, is the mental and moral qualities distinctive to an individual. It's who you are when ain't nobody watching. It's the things that you are prone to do. I watch a lot of that Detective ID channel. They had a couple on there yesterday, a young couple. They were trying to live together, and the girl was working and the boy wouldn't work because he was trying to start a singing career. And so he told her he had a plan for them to get money to pay the bills. His plan was to rob cab drivers. Now, it was a bad idea because he shot and killed two cab drivers. How long do you think you can get away with killing somebody? We look at this stuff on TV, look at it on Empire, and you think you can kill somebody, take them out back, bury them, pick them up and put them in the car for them, you can do it. That is TV. TV, that don't work in real life. Because she had to try five times before she was able to complete it. The first time she went in the water, she was 22 years old. The water was so rough, it had such big swells in it that they had to take her out of the water. The second attempt, she was 29 years old. She gets in the water, and the suit, whatever, lets in so much coldness that she had an asthma attack. Once again, her team had to fish her from the water. Now, I don't know about you, but me, I would say, well, you know, that's just not for me. But this is in Diana's spirit. The third attempt, she was bitten by box jellyfish. And she almost died. They had to, she still to the day has problems from obtaining so many jellyfish bites. She went back in the water on her fourth attempt. She was 62 years old. She was 62. Most of us would say after our 40s, it's too late for that. She was 62 years old when she went back in the water on her fourth time, and a hurricane came up. That would have been another sign unto me. Maybe it's just not meant for me. But at 64 years old, Diana goes back to Cuba. This time when she goes, she's got a special made bodysuit that keeps out the hypothermia. She's got a special mask that she puts on there. When the jellyfish come, they won't bite her face. These are shark infested waters. But she swam 110 miles from Cuba to Miami at 64 years of age. It was a 35-year quest, but she didn't give up. See, there's still things for her to do. You know, even though embarrass us, the more challenges we face, the more qualified we become for this Christian race.
Amen.
Paul says in verse 4 that endurance develops strength of character.
Mm-hmm.
And character, strength, as weightlifters say, where Sean at? No pain,
no pain.
No pain. No shame, no humility. No failure, no faith building. No embarrassment, no investment. But see, you're not going to get embarrassed if you don't ever try anything. But you got to step out sometimes on faith, the things that God has told you to do. There's still things God is telling our seniors on the move that they need to be doing. There's still things that we need to do here at South. Some of these children need somebody to read to. We need a home reading program. Somebody can just sit here and listen to children read.
Yes.
My grandmother taught me how to read.
Yes.
And she didn't really know how to read. I said, Mama, she'd give me the Bible to read. And I said, didn't you say you couldn't read? And she said, yeah, not that much. I said, well, how do you know I'm reading this right? She said, because I know what it's going to sound like. Now, boy, I'm reading. There's still things that we need to be doing, sisters.
Yeah.
David says in Psalms 119:71 that my suffering was good for me, for it taught me to pay attention to his decrees. Sometimes God needs to get our attention. Maybe we need to get some junk out of the trunk. Set some things in order. The world calls this growing up. But we cannot remain children depending on others to protect us forever. If we are to live faithfully to our Lord, then we must develop our character.
That's right.
Lastly, Paul explains how problems help us to see how much God loves us. Because in verse 4 it says, and endurance develops strength of character, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. And this hope will not lead to disappointment, for we know how dearly God loves us, because he's given us the Holy Spirit to fill our